Hi guys, welcome to the Visual Flow on AWS Installation Guide. My name is Dimitri. Today I'll show you how to get Visual Flow installed in your AWS account. First of all, go to Visual Flow landing page on the AWS Marketplace. Here you can find general information about Visual Flow and the terms of use. To run Visual Flow, we'll be using a service called EKS. Visual Flow is free, you pay only for the infrastructure based on your configuration choices. To continue, we should subscribe. Next, accept the terms of the subscription. Once subscribed, click to continue the configuration and select the delivery method, which is deployment into EKS. Then select the latest version of Visual Flow. Here is a link to the installation and user guide. Click continue to launch, which leads you to the instructions and the Helm chart. Let's open the installation guide now. A few quick notes. Before you get started with Visual Flow, you should install several things. The AWS command line interface, the Kubernetes command line tool, EKS CTL, which is a utility for creating and managing Kubernetes clusters on Amazon EKS. Please check the Amazon documentation first. Another thing you should do is install Helm. Helm is a package manager for Kubernetes that helps define, install, and upgrade Kubernetes applications. And finally, Git to download the repository. If this is the first time you install the AWS CLI, you should do the initial setup. Log in using your access and secret keys. Once in, create an EKS cluster. It's going to take about 20 minutes. This is done using EKS CTL. The first parameter is cluster name. To create your cluster with a Fargate Linux node, you should copy and paste the following line. Below, you can see a link to the Amazon documentation. Please go through it in case something doesn't work. Alternatively, you can leave your questions under this video and we'll try to help you. As you see in our example, this node is being deployed to the US East 1 region, to the 1C and 1D zones. I will speed up the video now. Some quick tips. The Fargate service is times cheaper than a decent dedicated server, but it is also a lot slower. You should also take into consideration that the Fargate profile is a specific feature of the Fargate cluster, and creating it takes time. You need a Fargate profile for each project. I recommend for all the actions to be performed from the admin/root AWS account, so you don't need to worry about access policies. Once the EKS cluster is ready, we need to run some checks. To do this, we copy and paste the first command line to check whether the cluster is configured and working properly. Here we see that our cluster is running on two nodes, and the second command tells us that there are two core DNS services running. If you already created the cluster, run this command to connect to it. Check the access once done. Here you also find the information on how to handle an authorization error if it occurs and how to get access for another user. Then you should install an AWS Load Balancer controller to provide access to the cluster from the internet. Otherwise, the cluster will be available only to AWS accounts and their servers. To start the installation, we should upload and install a policy file, then define the access levels. You will get an error message if a policy with the same name already exists. Next, we should export account ID. It is generated here, you just need to copy and paste it. This ID refers to your AWS account that you can find in the AWS console. Then we should create an IAM service account. It is a Kubernetes user with the appropriate permissions. After that, we should add the repository with the Helm chart of AWS Load Balancer controller. Next, we should set VPC ID. It is defined in the configuration installation file. This is the network name that was created for the cluster and set as a parameter to install AWS Load Balancer controller. We need it if we're going to use a Fargate cluster. The name of the service account is also specified here. Now AWS Load Balancer controller is installed and we should wait for it to start up. Let's move on to Visual Flow installation. To initiate this process, we should download the Visual Flow repository. Here you find the information on how to configure Slack notifications should you need them, but we move on. Let's go ahead and specify the super users, otherwise you will not get access to Visual Flow. To do this, we should make changes in the YAML file. Replace the parameter value, your GitHub nickname, with your GitHub account name or a list of names. Visual Flow uses third-party services, Kubemetrics and Argo workflows. These services will be installed in the Helm chart by default, so if they already exist, there will be a conflict. So our next two steps will make sure they don't. Neither service is installed. Kubemetrics tracks the utilization and availability of critical resources such as CPU, memory, and storage. Kubernetes provides a metrics API and a number of command line queries that allow to retrieve snapshots of resource utilization relatively easily. Argo workflow is used to launch each workflow in a separate pod and send notifications to a Slack channel if any of the tasks fail. As in our case, both services were not installed, we can go ahead and initiate Visual Flow installation and check if the app is successfully installed and all pods are running. It will take a few minutes. I'm speeding up the video again. To avoid using Amazon Route 53 web service that is paid, we run the following command in the CLI and get an auto-generated app's hostname for free. If you prefer to use a custom domain name, you should use Amazon Route 53. We can connect the application to a personal or organization user account. We use GitHub because it's readily available. I will add the app to my personal account, copy and paste the link to your browser. Click Register a new application. Set homepage URL. Use the following line and paste the generated app's hostname. Then give your application a name. Set authorization callback URL. And click the Register Application button. Now let's create an authorization. We can see here the ID generated and should generate a new client secret. This parameter becomes visible only once, and if you don't save it, you will need to generate it again. So we save the ID and the secret and proceed to edit the YAML file. In here, we update the ID, the secret, and strategy callback URL. Then we exit and start the update. We wait until the update is installed and all the pods are running. The old parameter will be replaced with a new one. I will speed up the video again now. Once that's done, put the homepage URL to your browser and start your work. In the next video, we'll tell you how to create your first ETL project. But what if you need more users? To add a new user, you should navigate to the user's GitHub profile settings and set their email to public. To do this, go to the Email tab. Make the email public by unchecking the Keep My Email Address Private checkbox. Save the updates. After that, the admin assigns a role to the new user. I will end this video by showing how to manage your Visual Flow subscription and how to delete EKS. There are two ways to unsubscribe from Visual Flow. The first one is through the AWS Marketplace. Go to Manage Subscription, click Manage, Actions, and Cancel Subscription. Or run the following command in the AWS CLI. To delete EKS, follow the link. I hope that was useful. Also, check out the links in the description. If you have any questions, leave them in the comment section or email us directly. Make sure to subscribe to our channel for more Visual Flow stuff. Thanks for watching. I see you in the next video.